Now, let's get more on our top story, the fact that Abu Qatada was released today after winning the latest stage of his deportation battle, and the government is seeking to appeal against yesterday's ruling. Well, joining us here to discuss it is Carl Gardner, who's a former government lawyer and legal blogger. And also in our Central London studio, we have Robin Simcox from the foreign policy think tank, the Henry Jackson Society. So, gentlemen, very good evening to you both. Carl, first of all, what are the government's options, do you think, now? I mean, clearly David Cameron really unhappy, says he's fed up. What can they do?
Well, I think at the moment they have to pursue a twin-track strategy. On the one hand, pursue this appeal that Theresa May said she's so keen on, but at the same time, I think they really need to enter into new negotiations with the Jordanians. What really matters here is additional assurances that can be got from Jordan, specifically about the use of what's been called the torture evidence in this case, statements given in past trials against Abu Qatada.
What would they have to do, the Jordanians, do you think, to persuade the judges here that Abu Qatada can be deported?
Well, there's a lot of talk about them changing their criminal code, perhaps to make it clear that this kind of evidence would only be admissible in a Jordanian court if the prosecution could prove it wasn't obtained by torture. But most effectively of all, I think, would be an absolute cast-iron guarantee that those statements simply will not be used in this case. That would do the trick, I think.
Robin, what's your view on this? Because clearly the government's already leaned quite heavily on the Jordanians. It looks like it's going to have to put more pressure on them still.
It will, for sure, and I think it just heightens the sense, unfortunately from the government's point of view, of complete and utter impotence on this issue. This issue has been going on now for the best part of a decade. Abu Qatada was never even in the country legally. And so the fact that that they still have been unable to deport him, and I think the fact that this was a British court, this was SIAC, rather than a European court, has only just heightened the sense that Abu Qatada has almost fallen through the cracks of what this country can do legally. And it's a very embarrassing position for the government to be in, and of course raises the question, if deportation does fail, if the appeal doesn't work, if we can't remove Abu Qatada to Jordan, what on earth is the government going to do with him? He's just going to become almost a festering sore for this government and future governments to have to deal with, the Al-Qaeda associated cleric that they couldn't deport.
And we hear it might be costing something like £5 million a year to keep tabs on him. But I mean, you know, you get suggestions from people like Peter Bone, the Conservative MP, that we should just deport him, kick him out anyway, whether that's legal or not. But clearly, you know, government will find it very hard to just break the law like that.
That's right. Theresa May made the point in the House of Commons yesterday that not only would that be about ministers breaking the law and the rule of law, they'd be asking civil servants, even airline staff, to be breaking the law. I think that in all of this argument, one understands the frustration of politicians, but at least the letting the courts handle this kind of issue, not just the British courts, but also the international courts, at least gives the British government a standard according to which it can deal with this type of case, and there's not just Abu Qatada, in the future there'll be perhaps lots of these cases, deal with them to a clear, consistent standard, and we'll be able to say to not just to countries like Jordan, but to other countries, perhaps in cases with people that we're more sympathetic to, that these decisions are made not by politicians and not on a sort of pick and mix basis, but on a consistent standard. That's the benefit that human rights standards and courts offer.
Robin Simcox, quite a lot of people say, if he's such a dangerous person, you know, he's once described as Osama bin Laden's right-hand man in Europe, if he was so dangerous, why not prosecute him here in the UK? Why not put him on trial here? But there just doesn't seem to be the evidence.
Yeah, well, I think this is the ultimate red herring, and there's two points on this. First of all, a lot of the intelligence we're told is from sensitive intelligence sources. So that's the first part, and it can't be disclosed in open court. But the second part, and I think more important point, is that let's say we could prosecute him for some of the statements he's made in a similar way to the way we did, for example, with Abu Hamza, where he was convicted of soliciting murder and inciting racial hatred. Now, that led to a 7-year sentence. Let's say we did convict Abu Qatada, that's still a 7-year, he's already been detained for the best part of a decade, so even if he was convicted, the likelihood is we'd have to release him straight away anyway and we'd be faced with exactly the same problem. I think everyone believes, and I certainly do, that the ideal situation would be to convict Abu Qatada in court, but we can't pretend that that's going to be a fix-all problem, because it simply won't be.
And Carl Gardner, this has been going on for, well, more than a decade now. Six Home Secretaries, I think, three Prime Ministers have been trying to get rid of him. Do you foresee a day when he will actually be getting on a plane out of this country?
I think probably. In a sense, I mean, this is very frustrating, but in a sense now, this narrows down to something very small. It's the question of the use of these two old statements in court. If those can be got definitively off the table, Jordanians absolutely guarantee not to use them.
But would they then have a case against him if they didn't use that against him?
I think so, because we understand from the court judgments that these witnesses will be prepared to give live evidence at a new trial. And you could argue about the fairness of that. But the courts have narrowed it down just to these old statements, so they could be got out of the way.
And Robin, a final view from you. Do you think ultimately, they will get rid of him?
I hope so. I mean, who knows now? This whole thing's become such a litigious mess. My instinct is that, yes, eventually he will, but I don't think it'll be any time soon, and he's going to be an embarrassment, unfortunately, for the government for quite a while yet.
All right, well, really good to talk to both of you. Robin Simcox and Carl Gardner, many thanks to both of you.